Okay, let me see. Perfect. Everything is fine. Sorry for that. Now, as I said, there is the result is different. So let me see what's going on here. It's sin alpha. Everything should be fine. But let me just see 1 second. I try to run it again. So it's let me source. The function, very good, and then moorings. Okay, so is 510, while here in the web page it gives to me just 1 second. It gives to me 392, which should be okay. Let me 13. Okay, so. CV is 1.3, okay. Side area is 950, okay. Just let me just make a check very quickly. Sin pi f. Okay, this is perfect. And then W. It's 92.6 divided by 3.6. Yes, this is correct. Square, it's okay, divided by 2. Let me just check, but this shouldn't be. I put a parenthesis here, but it doesn't make any difference. It's just for clarity. Let me see. I rerun it. It's still 510. Let me see. CV. Let me see. CW equal 1. Okay. It seems that I used the CW equal 1. Okay. Okay, so I need to correct the web page because I used the CW equal 1, and I tell you why, because I in another exercise which I saw it was they adopted 1, and this is why here I made a computation with 1. So no problem. I mean, let's take the result from the script, and then I will correct in the web page. And let me see W113. Okay, perfect. Now we have to compute the yaw moment. So the yaw moment it's computed in this way. So in order to compute the yaw moment, we have to multiply the wind force times the displacement of the center of gravity of the windage area with respect to the pivot point. So the wind force is acting on the center of gravity of the windage area. The ship is rotating around the pivot point, and therefore there is a displacement of the wind force with respect to the pivot point and eccentricity. And therefore, I have to multiply this wind force times this displacement. And the way to get the displacement is to multiply the length waterline times a coefficient that actually it's an empirical coefficient. Because actually the displacement, which is again the distance between the center of gravity of the windage area and the pivot point, is an intrinsic behavior, a geometric behavior of the ship. So basically it's something that we should know on basing on our knowledge of the geometry of the ship. But actually, there are empirical rules for estimating it. And one empirical rule is this graph that you can see here, that depending on the angle of approach, you get angle of approach of the wind, in our case is 90, you get an estimate for this coefficient CXYW, which multiplied by the length water line gives to you the displacement that we are looking for. And here you see that if you take 90 as angle of approach, you get a coefficient of about minus 0.04. Keep in mind the negative value, it's written here, means anti-clockwise rotation. Okay, because a negative value, negative moment means anti-clockwise, so it's positive clockwise. So the value that we are interested in is 0.04. And in this case, we have to put it in the formula. So first of all, I go back to the function. Let's note that contrary to what I assumed at the beginning, I need to put an argument, which is the length of the water line, LWL, it's equal, the default value is 117. It's put this indication here in the list of the arguments. Good. Now, let's compute the U moment. So let's call it YM, or how is called here, just one second, it's called MW. So MW is equal to our coefficient minus 0.04 times length water line, and this is the displacement of the wind force with respect to the pivot point, times the wind force PW. Okay, very good. This is what we need. Of course, the result will be different with respect to what is shown in the web page, because there is again CW, which is in that case one. We are using 1.3 here. Now, let's try to run the program, and now we have to return two things: the wind force and the yaw moment. So I suggest that we make a list then, which will include all the variables, all the output variables that I'm getting from this function. So here I write output equal list, and between parentheses I write PW equal PW, comma, MW equal MW. I'm not really sure that this works. Let's see. I think yes, but I'm not really sure. Let's see. Now let me save it. Let me source it. And then let's try again to run the function. Let me run it with the symbol W equal to 1, so we can compare with the web page. Okay, but now we are getting only one output, which is not what I wanted to get. So let me see what's wrong here. Ah, okay, I put return PW. I should put return output. Output. Okay. Very good. Now let me save it, source it, and then let me try to run it again. Okay, so what we get is, you see, a list in output. PW is 392, and MW is something 18, minus 1800. Let me now check on the web page if everything is okay. The web page, let's see. Yes, you see that the moment is 1800. Very good. So we are all set for the first part. only thing, just let me go back to RStudio. The only thing is that, let me expand the console. At this stage, we have to run it with CW equal 1.3, and these are the results I am interested in. Okay, very good. Now, let's, as I said, for the first part, I just have to correct the results on the web page, but this is easy, I will do that. For the first part, we are done, so the first question is okay. Let me go back to the web page then, and let me have a look at these questions. So, compute the wind force and yaw moment, we are done. Now, let's go to the second question. Read the procedure here below for computing mooring forces, then make a trial computation. Let's read the procedure first, okay? So, let's go down. You know, this part, I could have included it in a lecture because it's more like theory than an exercise. And I wanted to put it here because I'm not interested really, I'm not directly interested in this part. I think it is useful if you know it. I'm not asking anything at the exam about computation of mooring forces. I think it is useful, as I said, if you know this problem. On the other hand, I didn't want to put it in the lectures because what is in the lectures is something which is really specific and something that I am supposed also to consider a central part of my course. And so I prefer to put it here. Maybe that in the future I will change the location. So let's read this part. And let me start by reading this part here. Computation of mooring forces is a complex problem, as in general, the ship is a rigid body with 3 degrees of freedom, which is anchored with elastic mooring lines. Actually, it's berthed, not really anchored. Let me, because we are not using anchors here. And let me take a note. I'll correct it. Okay, we refer here to the computation method which is proposed by the Department of the Naval Sea Systems Command. It's a United States department, and there is a link to this rule. It's this computation method. It was proposed in 1987. It's a little bit, it's an old reference. It's a simplified method. I think it is very useful to get a perspective because it's simplified, is relatively easy to study. So I think to get a basic perspective is really useful. Of course, as usual, if you had to design moorings, you should check what are the suggested guidelines in the location of reference, what are the suggested procedure and the laws in force. So this rule, which was proposed for the United States in 1987, is not necessarily still valid even for the United States. It's just a very basic rule, which is described there, but it's not necessarily the current law in force. And this happens in many cases. In many cases, we teach simplified methods for making a computation, which in practical application often cannot be used, because in practical application, you have laws in force that suggest you that, for instance, simplified methods cannot be used. So you have to be always aware of the fact that what we study is for educational purposes. And for educational purposes, we need simple methods, because if I give you a very complicated one, we don't have time to get all the details, and also is more difficult to understand. So we need to start from the simple concepts, and I think this is ideal to start. Now, let's look at this link. If you click here, this is a document that is available on the web. If you click on the link, you get to a page where you can download the file. Okay, so here if I click on download PDF, then should start my download. Let me see. Click the download PDF button. Where, okay, it's here. It's a bit complicated, but at the end you get it. I just wanted to check. Yeah, you see. Let me open it with a PDF reader. Okay, here it is. Okay, this is the document. And I just wanted to show it to you because I think this is an excellent document to get an overview of the theory of the calculation for mooring systems. As I said, it is something that is tangential to our subject because it's more related to structural mechanics, but still, I think it is interesting that I give to you a link. And this is also the basis for several of the softwares that are used in practical applications. Okay, let me close these windows. Very good. Now, the method is, as I said, simplified, and it's based on the following assumptions. Let's have a look at them. Just one second, I didn't put the chat on my second screen, so let me put it there because I want to make sure that I don't miss your question. I shouldn't miss them because I have also the phone that is online, but I want just to make sure that I have the full control of this complicated system that I set up at home. Okay, so the assumptions. First, the elastic modulus of the mooring lines does not vary with mooring forces. And this is something that it's valid within a certain limit. You know that even for structures, the elastic modulus can be assumed to be constant within certain limits of stress. So we make this assumption here. Then mooring line arrangement is symmetrical with respect to the ship transversal axis, which means that if you break the ship in two pieces, on the one end you have the stern and on the other end you have the bow, basically the mooring lines are symmetric with respect to the center line let's say, with respect to the transversal axis of the ship. Okay. Now, this transversal axis is perpendicular to the ship's center line and it's centered on the ship's pivot point. So the y-axis, you see here that is written, we will refer to it as the y-axis. The y-axis is perpendicular to the ship's center line and it's centered on the pivot point. The ship center line will be referred to as the x-axis. Okay, very good. Now, the yaw moment and lateral force, I could select it, are applied at the ship pivot point. Here there is written center of gravity. I need to change it because center of gravity was the term that was used in the document that I downloaded, but I want to change it to make it consistent with the terminology that I use here. Okay, then the mooring lines are assumed to run horizontally, and this is our assumption. And see the document if you are interested in relaxing this assumption. Actually, the document makes use of a version of the calculation method which relaxes this assumption. Okay, now there is a step-by-step procedure for calculating the mooring forces. Now, first, we need to take x and y coordinates of bits and of the mooring line on board and bollards and of the mooring line on berth for each mooring line. Okay, now also I think we also need the coordinate. Okay, let's see, because I think we need also the position of the chocks, but let's see later. Determine horizontal length of each mooring line Li from bits to bollards. So we need to get the horizontal length of each mooring line. And then this means that I also need the coordinates of the chocks. So let me take a note, because this is something that we need to write there. Okay. Determine the total cross-sectional area AI of each mooring line. So it's the cross-sectional area of the rope. But keep in mind that usually the mooring lines are composed by more than one rope. So here there is written that this cross-sectional area is the product of the rope cross-section times the number of parts per mooring line, normally three. So each mooring line normally has three separated ropes. Okay, here there are two more points than needed. One second, because I take my notes. Now, determine the elastic modulus EI for each mooring line from producer. This is a behavior of the material. Okay. Now, determine the angle theta 1 between each mooring line and the y-axis. And here, see figure 1. Let's have a look at figure 1. Here is another step where I need the coordinate of the chocks. Let's see figure 1. It's here. You see that the theta I, again, let me refresh. One second, because this is the old figure. Okay. You see theta I, look at the bow of the ship. The theta I is the angle between the mooring line and the y-axis. Positive or negative, it depends. We have to decide what is the sign. I suggest that in this case, if you look at the bow of the boat, the theta I that is indicated there, I suggest to take it positive. Okay. And you see that you need the coordinate of the chocks in order to compute this angle. We don't have these angles and coordinates of bits, bollards, and chocks. And this is something that if we want to make a computation, we have to decide. And you can have a look at this figure, and then you know the total length of the ship, the waterline length, and then you can decide the coordinates. I suggest that if we move forward with the computation, I suggest that we take a simplified scheme with only six mooring lines, but we can decide this later. Okay, let me go down. So we are here, determine the angle theta I. Okay, now determine the length of the mooring line between the chock and the mooring bits, as well as the length between the chock and the bollard. Actually, you may say that this is implicit with this. So this point that is selected now is implicit in the second bullet point. Okay, it's implicit, but let's keep it explicit. So we are here, determine the length, as well as the length between the chock and the bollard. And here I put a link, see here, to see a picture of a chock in order to clarify what a chock is. Okay, determine the total breaking strength of each mooring line, and let's call it BS, breaking strength. And this is given by the producer, okay? And this allows us to determine the safety factor at the end of the story. Now, determine the spring constant for each mooring line, and the spring constant is given by this expression here. Remember that AI is the cross-sectional area, EI is the elastic modulus, LI is the total length. Okay. Now we have to determine the spring component in the y direction, which is, the spring constant. It gives the elongation, the increasing length, allow you to compute how long a mooring line gets under wind forcing. But this increase of length is inclined with respect to the y-axis. So let's compute the component of this increasing length along the y-axis. Okay, now we need to determine this displacement KYI. We need to determine this product, displacement KYI times XI, where XI is the, sorry, the XI is the abscissa of the chalk. Okay, XI here is the X coordinate of the chalk. And then let's determine this second quantity. Okay, here it becomes, starting from here and up to here. Let's say the computation becomes the application of a methodology of structural mechanics in order to determine what are the mooring forces in this specific case when there is a rigid body which is connected with more than three mooring lines and with elastic mooring lines. Now, we don't go into the details of this procedure. Let's just apply it, okay? Because this, as I said, it's a problem of mechanics. We don't want to go into the details here, okay? I think that you have the basis, the theoretical basis to understand it. But for now, let's just take the process as it is. So determine this product, determine this quantity here, take the following summations. Okay, and then I remove the selection because you can see them more clearly. Okay, and now apply the total external lateral force PW and yaw moment MW to the ship's pivot point, okay, at its location, its coordinate, which is under the assumptions that we made, it's zero. Now we can compute, according to this expression, the ship's translation in the y direction. So it's due to the fact that the mooring lines are elastic and then the ship translate. Okay, and then there is this second expression to calculate the rotation around the vertical axis and around the pivot point. Okay, and for each line, calculate its force component according to this expression. Here there is a round parenthesis that is missing. Just one second. Okay. Once that you know the force along each mooring line, compute the line tension forces. This is quite, it's just a trigonometric transformation, and then you can compute the safety factor, which is given by the breaking strength divided by the tension forces. Okay. And then there is the last step, which is a check. The check is that the sum of the mooring forces in the y direction along each mooring line is equivalent to the total wind pressure. And I think here I should use another symbol. It's not Fy, we use another symbol above. Okay, so now let me conclude this computation. First of all, one consideration. It's quite complicated. So I checked in other courses in harbor engineering, this is not dealt with. They don't treat this because it is mentioned that it's indeed a complicated computation, which we can resolve only in very simplified conditions, and therefore it is usually skipped. Actually, I prefer to propose it to you because I think you need to know the basis, but I propose that we don't go into the details, and actually, I wouldn't be prepared myself to understand what are the motivations and the assumptions behind these computational steps. But actually, what I would like to propose to you, if you want, and if you want to get engaged with this, is try to make an example of application. Actually, I will do it. I will do it because I want to check that everything is fine, and the way to check it is to make this final check here. So the sum of the components along each mooring line should be equivalent to the wind pressure. And I think this would be interesting. As I said, we could simplify with like four or six mooring lines, and then we can remove some of them in the figure above. We need to fix the coordinates of the chocks, bits, and bollards, but then I think this would be an interesting computation. And I am sure that if we get engaged with the computation, we can understand much more of the underlying basis. And if you are interested, you could try to explore what are the mechanics concepts that are behind this simplified computation. This is just a proposal. If you would like to make such an exercise, I think it may be interesting to discuss also the way to present it at the exam, and could be for you a way to present like a very short presentation at the exam on the computation that you made. And I would be willing to revise these presentations before the exam. I would be willing to support you and help you. And then, if the exercise is interesting, everything goes fine, I think it would be also a nice addition for me to include in these web pages. There is one thing that I wanted to tell you. As you see, because this is still a draft, there are several things that I need to fix, and I will do quite soon. These corrections that I spotted out here are I will do them probably already in the afternoon or tomorrow at the latest. I'm sorry. But there is to say that besides these corrections, I adapted a little bit the explanation because I found that in some instances it was not very clear. So I suggest you, if you decide to get engaged in this, to also have a look at the document because it may help you to understand the concepts that are behind. Otherwise, you may decide to forget the second part of the exercise. It's not a problem at all. Okay? It's just an opportunity that I wanted to give to you. I would say that at this stage I would pass back to the lectures, and I propose that we don't move forward with this also in our studio. I go back to our studio because moving forward requires time, so I prefer to go back to the lectures and leave this option of moving forward to you. For what is the first part of the exercise, we are fine. We did it. It's quite easy, as you see, but still, it's a preparation. If you want to move forward, it's the starting point. Okay, any question on that? Okay, so let me close our studio then. Let me just save. It's already saved. Perfect. Given that it's 11:40, I suggest that we make our long break now, 15 minutes. If you agree. Okay, perfect. See you then in 15 minutes. Thanks a lot. Okay, students, here I am. Now, just 1 second. Okay, the chat is okay, perfect. So, now let's put aside this exercise and let's go to the next lecture then. So, 1 second. Okay, let's go back here. Good. Now, the next lecture would be design of breakwaters. This is something that you already did with Professor Archetti, but I would like to just dedicate limited time with you to go through this web page because there are some of the things that are discussed there which will be new for you. So what I would like to do is actually, just 1 second, and let me then open this web page. What I would like to do with you now is to quickly go through it. Quickly means not really quickly, means maybe like half an hour. So this is a complement, an integration to what you did with Professor Archetti, and we agreed that I should give to you some additional details here. And the reason why I give additional details is that I want to make sure that you know what are some specific issues that are important for breakwaters which are used to protect arbors. And I will ask you to have a look at this lecture then. And it's, I mean, going together through it is useful, but on the other end, as usual, there are several empirical formulas. I think it is useful just because so I can take the opportunity to tell you what is the message that I suggest you to get from this web page, and what is what I suggest to retain. First of all, what you see here in this picture is what is called a rubble mound breakwater. So it's a breakwater that is made by putting rock units in place. We have other solutions that can be used and which are described here, but let's go through it. And first of all, what is the purpose of a breakwater? you know already, so I don't spend time on this. And basically, if we refer to harbors, the purpose of breakwaters is there are two main purposes. The first one is to create a protected environment in the harbor, therefore attenuating waves in order to provide the facilities for sheltering the ships in a convenient way. And this is one thing. Another thing is that breakwater can be used to protect the entrance of harbors from sediment transport, therefore reducing the dredging operations. It is indeed important that when we design an harbor, it is indeed important that we try to limit to the necessity of dredging. It is important that we try to predict what could be a structural defense against dredging. Against dredging means against sediment transport, because if you get sediment transport entering into an harbor, then the reduced turbulence into the protected area of the harbor, of course, induces the settlement, the sedimentation of the sediments. And therefore, there is the need periodically to dredge the sea bottom into the harbor in order not to reduce the capability, the possibility for ships to maneuver. Dredging into an harbor is something that it's relevant, it's inconvenient because of the environmental impact of it. We already discussed that when we dredge an harbor, we get the problem of displacing the sediments, the results from that dredging, which is often contaminated by pollutants. And this is indeed a very relevant problem, which is becoming today indeed very pressing, because of the contamination and the need to displace the contaminated muds properly. This is becoming, for portual authorities, a matter of real concern. So, whatever we can do to limit the deposition of sediments, it's very appropriate. And breakwater can be used also to this purpose, because in a way they have the capability to redirect sediment transport, because they redirect waves, they may also redirect currents, and in this way they protect against sediment deposition. Also, if you remember the case that we studied for sand bypassing, the Tweed Bay project, I think this was the name, which is linked in our web pages. The sand bypassing was made necessary because they protected the entrance to the river, so the entrance to the harbor, with the sea walls and breakwaters. And the breakwaters, and in this case, I think they also used groynes. They blocked the sediment transport with these structures. So this is why for harbors, breakwater are maybe important, like groynes. This is why we study them. And it is indeed important then that we understand how hydrodynamics is modified by breakwaters. Unfortunately, breakwaters, as many marine structures, are complicated structures. They are not regular. They interact with waves, which is a random process, with also chaotic behaviors. Chaotic behaviors means that it's difficult to predict them. Even if you have a full understanding of the physics, it's not easy to predict them. And unfortunately, I say they are They are complicated. Very often they are studied into the lab. I'm very sorry that I cannot have the opportunity to bring you in the lab in Bologna, where we study also these infrastructures in a small scale. And I think I will replace this visit in the lab with a lecture. If I have time next Tuesday, I would like just to say something briefly on what is the concept behind testing these structures into the lab in a small scale. So it's a problem that cannot be studied really effectively on mechanistic basis, and therefore we study it in the lab or through empirical formulas. First of all, keep in mind that this figure, I put this figure here because you see what is the modification of the beach that was induced by breakwater. And in particular, in this case, you see the creation of a tombolo. The tombolo is a stripe of sand connecting the beach with the breakwater. And it happens frequently when you have consistent across-shore sediment transport, which means that you have a continuous movement up and down of sediments in the cross-beach direction, so not along the coast, but it's not along shore, but it's across-shore direction. When you have a consistent sediment transport in the cross-shore direction, if you put a breakwater, what you obtain is that the transport of sediments is blocked by the breakwater, and a very quiet zone is created behind it, which means that the sediments that bypass the breakwater on the sides then settle down behind the breakwater. And this causes the creation of this stripe of sand connecting, in these conditions, the beach with the breakwater. This is called the tombolo. So we need to understand these processes, how the breakwater changes the transport of sediments and the hydrodynamics behind it. And we will use the term lee zone to identify the sea area behind the breakwater, which is comprised between the breakwater and the beach. So this is the lee side of the breakwater, while we can talk of the offshore side of the breakwater to mean the opposite side. Also, we will term the top of the breakwater as the crest of the breakwater. The crest of the breakwater is typically displaced in a parallel direction with respect to the coastline. It's displaced, the crest, in the along shore direction. Okay, now, first, here there is a list of types of breakwaters. I think you already know this, so I'm not spending much time. As I said, the rubble mound is the type that is more used, but there might be other forms of breakwater like air bubble curtains or composite breakwater with a vertical monolithic top. And we can also use floating structures in order to mitigate the movement of the waves, etc. This is something that I will not ask at the exam, but I suggest you to have a look. I think, as I said, that you already discussed with Professor Archetti, but still, I think it is useful for you if you get a full perspective of the different types of breakwater that we can use. Okay, and again, I will concentrate on the rubble mound with and the units may be made by armor or by stones, or the units can be also shaped in a way like tetrapods that makes them more stable. And all these things I think you already know. Now let's concentrate on rubble mound breakwaters, and again, These are the shapes that you can use for harbor units, tetrapods. Let's understand. These are tetrapods. Okay. Let's go back. Three bars. 1 second. Okay, this is not. This is a broken link. Let me check the third one. Okay, this is a dolos. And three bars. Let me see if I can find something else. I need to fix this link. Three bars. One second. No. Okay, so let me see. Three bars. Ocean. Okay, here it is. So I need to adjust this. Here is a picture. A picture. I need to adjust the broken link. Let me take a note. Three bar broken. Okay. Let me go back to that. I think you already know that we can distinguish we can categorize breakwaters into two main categories. We distinguish between submerged breakwaters, or let's say they can be three categories actually, because the two main categories are the category of the structures that are designed to allow overtopping and the structure that are designed not to be overtopped. Usually, the structures that are designed not to be overtopped are equipped with a wall that is displaced on the crest of the breakwater. There is a third category, which is submerged breakwaters, which it's not mentioned here because it's less important for harbor engineering. Here is a typical structure of a rubble mount breakwater. They are usually built by following a structure that is a composite structure. There might be on the lee side a berm, and also on the offshore side they may have a berm, which is like a step, an horizontal step in the structure, which aims to create a larger base for the breakwater and to protect the crest. Because if you create this artificial berm, you modify the shape of the waves, you induce a wave breaking and therefore a partial dissipation of energy before the wave hits the breakwater. You see that breakwaters have a core usually, and the core is done by material that is more stable. And in order to get more, or let's say, more stable is not the correct wording, it's more compact. And in order to reduce the porosity, to increase the compact form of the core, we use a material that is of smaller size. And the core and the secondary armor may have a smaller size because in this way we reduce permeability. Reducing permeability is important for reasons that we will discuss in a moment, but actually I just wanted to tell you that, anticipate to you that reducing permeability may be important to avoid that there is a huge flow of water bypassing the breakwater through the body of the breakwater. And this is something that we really don't want. I will explain you later why. But of course, the core, given that is formed by more compact and therefore lower size material, needs to be protected. And this is why in the external part we put units of larger dimension, because in this way they protect the core. You see that the top is called the crest of the breakwater, What you get usually is a reduction of the wave energy, but still in the lee side, especially if you have some overtopping in extreme conditions, you have some waves. So the breakwater usually doesn't eliminate completely waves, but reduces their length, usually wavelength, and amplitude. And this is actually what we want in order to get a protected environment in the harbor. Now, here you see an example of a breakwater that is not to be overtopped, and in this case, you put this wall, which is called cap, on the top in order to avoid overtopping. In some cases, the breakwater can also serve as berths. And if you put the berm at a convenient depth on the lee side, you can use the breakwater to berth boats, small boats. And this is also a way to combine the protecting function with the berthing function into the harbor. Now, we need to estimate the wave run up and therefore the probability that the breakwater is overtopped. This is a classical problem in ocean engineering and harbor engineering. To estimate the wave run up, it means to estimate to what extent the wave can climb up on the offshore side the breakwater. And of course, if the wave run up exceeds the elevation of the crest, you have some overtopping. And this is indeed important to estimate because depending on the overtopping, you get an estimate of the wave behavior in the lee side, and you get an estimate of the volume of water that bypasses the breakwater, which will originate in turn a return current, which is something that we need to understand in detail, especially for what is related to harbors. So, how to estimate the wave run up? I think you took into consideration some formulas already with Professor Archetti. I just want to highlight with you what are the independent variables to determine the run up R. And these independent variables are related to the geometry of the breakwater and the bathymetry of the site, as well as the wave behavior. Actually, what is presented here in this form is the starting point. The basic concept of a dimensionless analysis, a dimensional analysis, because this is one way which we use to study breakwaters by using the Buckingham theorem, which I already mentioned to you, and dimensional analysis, we can set the basis for both the mechanistic understanding of the process and the experimental setup in a small scale lab. Because once that you determine the physical quantities, I remind you the concept of the Buckingham theorem. Once you determine the physical quantities that have an influence on the process, and you determine how many of them are independent, then by subtracting from the number of the physical quantities, the number of those that are independent, you end up with a reduced number with respect to the physical quantities, which is precisely the number of dimensionless variables which you can use to fully describe your process from a mechanistic point of view. And these dimensionless variables are, for instance, maybe the Reynolds number, maybe the Froude number, maybe the wave number. Once that you determine the dimensionless variables which suffice to describe your process, then these dimensionless variables should be preserved in your small scale model. So dimensional analysis is a way to couple, I say again, the mechanistic understanding of the process and the lab experiment that you have to set up in order to study the problem. So basically, through the mechanistic understanding, we determine how the lab experiment should be carried out. So this is why in these types of problems, most of the problems of maritime engineering, we use the dimensional analysis approach. And an essential step is at the beginning to determine what are the independent variables, independent physical quantities that we need to describe the process. And besides that, we need to determine what are the physical quantities that we need to get into play. So this is why at the beginning of the study of breakwater, we start by determining these physical quantities. And these are those that you see listed here. They are seven. So there is the incident wave height. This is for sure a physical quantity that determines how the process evolves. And then we have lowercase h t, the depth, the sea depth at the toe of the slope, at the toe of the breakwater. And then we have n, the porosity of the breakwater. And if the breakwater is composite, we need to find a representative value. The roughness of the slope, the wave period, the slope of the structure, and the slope of the sea bottom. So if we agree on this number of variables, which are seven, I would say that the independent ones are three, because it's in terms of units, I think we have only three units here, because we have length, we should have mass, and we should have also time, and which means that with four dimensionless variables, we can describe the process with four dimensionless numbers. And here is a scheme that describes this process of wave run-up in particular. Now, we don't go into the details here, and now I think we need to pass to an empirical formula. And several formulas have been proposed, and usually we estimate an extreme run-up, and the extreme run-up, it's usually defined as R for run-up 2%, which is the run-up level which is exceeded by only 2% of the incident waves. And here I am presenting to you a formula that should be different with respect to the one that Professor Archetti presented to you. And this is the formula of Van Ghent in 2001. It was derived, which depends on the variables that you see there. You don't have absolutely to learn this formula by memory. Absolutely not. The only thing that I wanted to tell you, to emphasize you once again, is that these empirical formulas usually were derived through lab experiments, and they are valid within the range the experimental range that was used to determine them. So, for instance, in this case, there is a range of validity which is dictated in terms of the surf similarity parameter. The surf similarity parameter is defined as you see here below. The meaning of the symbols is explained here. So just make sure when you use an empirical formula that you look at the range of validity of the formula itself, which is an essential point that you have to take care of. Okay, this is one possibility. Now let's look at two effects which are related to the amount of run-up, which I am very interested in. And the two effects are wave transmission and the setup effect, which we will describe later. Now, wave transmission, why I am interested in these two effects? Because they are relevant for designing arbors. Usually into an arbor, I have an idea of what is the max wave that I can tolerate, what are the wave behaviors that we can tolerate, and therefore it is important, given that we can estimate the wave behaviors offshore, it's important to determine, to estimate how wave propagates through breakwaters. Usually in the lee side, we get a reduced wave height with respect to offshore, and we can define coefficient which is called the wave transmission coefficient, which is the ratio of the wave heights offshore at offshore seaward, H high at the denominator, and lee side, HT. So what we expect, of course, is that KT is lower than 1 for obvious reasons, because we expect that the wave height HT lee side is reduced with respect to the wave height in the offshore side, HI in this case, which is at the denominator. And there are some rule of thumbs which we can use to get an order of magnitude. So if you have, and the rule of thumb is given in terms of the elevation of the crest of the breakwater ZC above the mean sea level. So if you have an elevation of the crest of the breakwater above sea level, above the mean sea level, divided by the wave height offshore, which is greater than 3/4, minor waves are generated on the lee side, which means that in general, let's take the extreme case. If you have that ZC is higher than H1, which means that their ratio is greater than 1, you expect no overtopping. And therefore, with no overtopping, you basically, if the breakwater is well projected with a reduced permeability, you expect that you have no waves on the lee side. Maybe that some wave you have anyway, because you always have some permeability. But of course, if the breakwater is never submerged, you don't expect big waves. Now, if you have the case where ZC is equal to 0, then you get KT, which is about 1/2. So if at the crest of the breakwater is located at the mean sea level, you have a KT of 1/2. So this gives to you an idea of what may happen in this case where you have the crest of the breakwater that is placed at the mean sea level. And then if you have the crest of the breakwater, if you have the breakwater that is submerged, you have the KT that it's increasing with respect to 1/2. And in particular, if you have that ZC divided by HE is lower than minus 0.5, KT is greater than 3/4. There is to say that, when you want to protect harbors, usually you don't use, as I said, submerged breakwaters because usually you want to really create a sheltered area, a protected area. And also another issue is that, when there is movement of boats a heavy traffic, it's preferable that breakwaters are visible. And it's of course true that you can use signals in order to let the boat driver know, but on the other hand, there is to say that in some conditions visibility may be low, and therefore usually we try to avoid I'm sorry, the use of submerged breakwaters when in proximity of the harbors. So these equations, this rule of thumb gives to you an indication. It gives to you a perception also of the order of magnitude of the kind of protection that you may give to these areas. Now, there are other empirical relationships that you can use to estimate KHT. Another empirical formula was proposed by van der Meer, which is displayed here. Again, this is something which is more refined with respect to the rule of thumb that I introduced to you just previously, but it's still empirical, something that you don't have to learn. And also, there is another formula which is mentioned here, the formula by van der Meer and Damen, which also takes into account the characteristic of the core material of the breakwater, which is again something that it's important because, as I said, the permeability plays a role. And here, the behavior of the core material is taken into account through D50. D50 is the sieve diameter corresponding to 50% of the weight of the core material. D50 is a typical parameter to identify the size of grains. And D50, as I said, being the sieve diameter corresponding to 50% in weight of the core material, is a classical identifier for an average size of the core material. And here in this formula, the composition, the size of the core material is taken into account, which is, a more refined way to also account for the internal behavior and the permeability of the breakwater. Again, here you have some limits of validity, which you have always to take care of. And I think that's it for wave attenuation by breakwaters. Something I say again, which I really want that you have clear in mind what is, and I really would like that you have clear in mind the orders of magnitude. This is why I consider, I'm going back now, this rule of thumb important, this one, because it gives to you an idea. And this is, as I said, the message that I would like you to keep, the meaning of a picture, a perception of what happens into an harbor area that is protected by breakwater. So you have to get a perception of overtopping, also a perception of displacement of sea level, which we'll discuss now, and a perception of the orders of magnitude. There is one last thing that I want to discuss with you, which is the water setup induced by breakwaters. What is the water setup? The water setup means that in the lee side of the breakwater, you get a higher sea level with respect to the seaside. And it is, what is the reason for that? Okay. You understand that it can be caused by overtopping. On the other hand, there are other phenomena that may contribute to it, which is permeability of the breakwater and water flow through the apertures. And what is the reason why you can justify from a physical point of view the fact that in the lee side, in the protected area, you have a higher water level? But think of a breakwater. A breakwater is a barrier between a high energy environment and potentially a lower energy environment, which is the protected area has a lower energy. But on the other hand, an equilibrium must be reached because, of course, if you have a higher energy of water on the offshore side, you may expect that in some way there is a water flow that goes towards the lee side. And this water flow, unless you can fully block it, but it's impossible because, I mean, there are entrances to the harbor, to the protected area, so you cannot really fully block this water flow. Given that you cannot fully block it, you have to expect that this difference in energy causes a water flow, again, from the ocean to the lee side. And to what extent this happens? It happens until you have a kind of equilibrium. And the equilibrium is precisely reached by an increase of the water level. So you increase the potential energy on the lee side, not you, but the ocean increases the potential energy in the lee side to compensate for a greater kinetic energy on the offshore side. And so this is the motivation why on the lee side, the higher the difference, the higher the turbulence, the higher the energy in the offshore side, the higher the increase in elevation on the lee side with respect to offshore. And this is called the setup induced by the breakwater. This setup, in turn, implies that you have a return flow which can happen maybe when the energy level offshore reduces. For instance, because wave height reduces, and then you have this return flow. And the return flow originates currents, which typically take place along the apertures, along the ways the boat follows to get in and out the harbor. And this is a kind of phenomena that you have to consider. You have to consider the fact that when you protect an area, you limit the energy in that area, but this causes a water setup. And this is something that in some cases you have really to take into account because it has an influence on the moorings, it has an influence on the berthing procedures. How to estimate this water setup? Again, with empirical formulas or lab experiments. Now, I can propose to you an empirical formula. It is something that you don't have absolutely to learn, and it is just interesting to see what are the independent variables. And these independent variables are the wave height on the lee side and the sum of incident and reflected wave height on the offshore side. And also, there are wave numbers on the sea side and lee side, respectively. And the effective variables are also the sea bottom depth with respect to the mean sea level on the sea and lee side respectively. So this is just to give you an idea that what you the setup depends on the wave heights on the two sides, which we can compute through the previous formula of wave transmission, and it depends on water depth and on the wave numbers. But again, this is a phenomenon that you have to take into account, because for extreme wave condition, it can originate consistent increases of the water level in the lee side and consistent return flows. Okay, and that's it about what I wanted to tell you. The stability of the armor units, we already studied it, so we don't need to discuss this. Okay, so any question on this? Okay, good. Let's go back. And let's move to climate change. Now, this page, it's a page that I built a couple of years ago to give a perspective of what could be the climate change impact in a number of disciplines related to civil engineering that have to deal with water. I felt that there was the need to build this page because while we have a fairly good knowledge of what is what climate change means in terms of temperature change, we all know about global warming, and it's relatively easy to find references on the web on global warming, which implies an increase of temperature, as we know. On the other hand, when we turn to the effect of global warming and climate change in general on water in its widest sense, these impacts are much more complicated to assess. So when we talk about increase of sea level, when we talk about extreme storms, extreme rainfall, extreme floods, extreme coastal floods, the impact of climate change is much more difficult to decipher. The scientific community is still much uncertain about what the impact of climate change on water, again, in its widest sense, is. So I thought that there was the need to try to propose a review of the state of the art, and I titled this lecture Climate Change and Water Cycle, but there is a consistent part which is devoted to sea level rise. And I think it is important that I include this part in harbor engineering, because climate change is becoming for harbor engineering a relevant concern in terms of sea level rise, first of all, but also in terms of the impact on extreme storms. You know, climate change is affecting our life into from several different perspectives, and it's impacting society in several different ways. It's also impacting for what concern the sea, the oceans, and the related engineering problems. This is a lecture that I propose to several of my courses, not all of them, but for instance, I also propose this lecture to the PhD students in physics, and also to several students, international students in other universities. So I thought that it's indeed interesting that I propose it to you. It will be quite long. We don't finish today. And it's mainly descriptive. It is basically not a subject for our exam. So it is something that it's not really related to your education, or let's say not related to your university student career, but I think it's an information, it's an overview that you really need to take, because otherwise, I mean, if you don't know the basics of climate change impacts, you are out from many professional problems that are today getting more important. I would say probably too much important. But on the other hand, it's certainly true that from a professional point of view, whatever you do in engineering, I mean, from conservation of historical buildings to seismic analysis, whatever you do, it becomes related to climate change. Maybe that it's not like that forever. Maybe that this is a concern that it's will mitigate in the future. But now, I think it is extremely important that you have it. You may say, okay, but if this is descriptive, I can get a glance, an overview by myself. There is no need that we dedicate a lecture to it. Actually, the problem of climate change is that the information is so large that getting an overview, it's extremely complicated. You really need to study a lot unless you get a useful advice. And so I really think that it's a good subject for education, first. And second, there is to say that given that it's a controversial topic, getting information is even more complicated, if possible. Third, while there is a large debate and large information on climate change and its causes, its implications, when you turn into technical guidelines that the engineer might use to perform design under climate change, the information is very, very sparse, and I would say in most cases there is nothing. So technical guidelines for climate change adaptation and mitigation, you see nothing. So the task of the engineer is complicated because on the one hand you get solicited to take climate change into account, on the other hand you don't have a technical basis for dealing with it. And this makes, I mean, dedicating a lecture to climate change really, in my opinion, important. Finally, keep into account one thing, that there is a lot of uncertainty, I think you realized it, about climate change, especially when you talk about something different from temperature. There is a lot of uncertainty, and uncertainty is something that it's very relevant to engineering because, I mean, when you make a mistake in design, you have an implication, legal implications with it. And the legal implications basically prescribe that you prove, if necessary, under a lawsuit in front of a court, you prove that you considered uncertainty in a reasonable way. But actually, when dealing with design under climate change, it's very unclear how we should get an estimate of uncertainty. And I think this exposes the engineer to professional risk. And also, I think, keep in mind, this is why scientists, climate scientists, often when they have to come to a solution. They want the engineer, they want the cooperation with the engineer. When it's time to make research, they say that the engineers have not the basis for making it because they are not expert in atmosphere physics, for instance. On the other hand, when it comes to a solution, they want the engineer. And the reason is precisely that they want someone taking the responsibility. And so I think that engineers are exposed to that. So this is another reason why I think it is useful if I discuss this issue with you. Before starting, after this premise, I suggest a 5 minutes break. Any question? Okay, so let's. Okay, here we are. So let me make an introduction to explain. For instance, I think, sorry, a premise. I think, let me look at the end of the lecture. I think there is a PowerPoint available, but I prefer to use, let me see, I am pretty sure there is a PowerPoint. No, it's not here. Okay, there is not. I can put it available, but in any case, I prefer to read on the web page, not on the PowerPoint, because given that you have the PC in front of you, I prefer that we look at the web page, which is more, I mean, the information is more complete. So, first of all, there is an introduction that I want to make to explain why the topic is controversial. And the topic is controversial because climate change is considered to be today a major threat to sustainability and a major threat to human development and human society in the coming, let's say, in the coming years, up to we made predictions up to 2100, 2100, which is these predictions are outlining that climate change may increase to an extent that it may trigger important transformations in the world societal setting, because some of the lands will become no more cultivable, other lands will become cultivable, but this means that we will need migrations in order to adjust to these changes, and therefore it's something that may threaten our current also political and societal setting. And also there are some of the predictions which outline that there could be at a certain point dramatic changes, because the justification for this is that the climate system is highly nonlinear. Highly nonlinear means that there might be threshold effects. Like if you have a steady increase in temperature, the system may be resilient to it up to a certain level. After that level, the system may suddenly change with dramatic changes. And I want to make you an example. In terms of sea level rise, there is the concern that if the temperature continues to increase, it may happen that the ice caps suddenly melt. And the reason for this may be that we know that below the ice caps there is a large volume of liquid water. The reason for the presence of this liquid water is that in the very deep frozen grounds, the ice pressure increases for the pressure of the ice standing above. And therefore, the increase in pressure decreases the ice temperature. I mean, it decreases the temperature to which the water passes to the liquid phase, to the ice phase. And therefore, the combined effect that there is The ice above that protects from very low temperature and it causes the freezing temperature to decrease below zero, causes the presence of large masses of liquid water into the ice caps, and some of these hidden and internal lakes were detected. Indeed, they have a very large volume. There are evidences that prove that the larger lakes on the Earth are those that are buried under the ice caps. So it's not clear what could happen if the temperature continues to increase and therefore the thickness of the ice cap decreases. It may happen that a decrease of the thickness lowers the pressure and then these hidden lakes get frozen. On the other hand, it may happen that they keep liquid and suddenly they break the ice crust and flush back into the ocean. And this may cause indeed a sudden melting of the ice caps, because at this point you would have water above, water below, and this means that probably there could be a kind of shock. I mean, this is something that occurred in the past. We had periods over the Earth where the ice cap was not there. Absolutely. There was no ice on the Earth's crust during some periods, but this was when humans were not there. Now we have a developed society, so if we got this sudden increase of the sea level, it would be a problem. And this is an example of what is called a tipping point, a threshold effect. And so there are some predictions for the future climate that foresee that this may happen. And therefore, unexpected consequences may occur above a certain point. But of course, this is uncertain. We don't have certainties. When we talk about climate, this is another concept that we have to learn and to keep well in mind. When we talk about meteorology, we don't have certainties. We know that meteorological predictions are uncertain. But when we talk about climatic predictions, uncertainty goes up. And therefore, there is no certainty. And therefore, this implies that there is a part of the scientific community that disputes these catastrophic predictions. And so, given that the issue is so important, these disputes become very controversial. The issue is important because it has economic implication, it has political implication, and it has indeed implications on society, on the wellness of people. So, for instance, some scientists are convinced that the risk that is currently induced by the pandemic is much lower than the risk that is induced by climate change. And keep in mind that, for instance, for the pandemic, virologists kept saying for many years that there was an incoming risk, but we didn't take the warning into account. Or some of them took it into account, but the society as a whole got unprepared to this risk of the pandemic. The same may happen for climate change, but the fact that it's climate change, these predictions are uncertain, then makes the issue very controversial. And this is not good because, I mean, for a person like us that has to work with the implications of climate change, the fact that there is controversy is not good at all. In fact, my hope in the future is that scientists get rid of this controversy because I think they should come to a unified vision where we recognize the uncertainties, we quantify the uncertainties. Actually, this is not possible today, not because it's impossible from a theoretical point of view. It's possible. From a theoretical point of view, we can estimate uncertainty of predictions. We know how to do that. But it's the structure of this debate that it's the controversy that makes it impossible to agree on a strategy, to agree, therefore, on a kind of uncertainty assessment. So, what are we talking about? So, once that we made this premise and we learned that unfortunately it's not a good thing that there is such a controversy. Can you imagine if under the pandemic we were not agreeing a strategy? I mean, during the pandemic, I think this didn't happen in Italy, or maybe that there were some difficult, diverse opinions on what to do, but at the end of the story, everybody agreed on the important pillars of this strategy. Everybody agreed that we had to stay at home. Everybody basically stayed at home, with few exceptions. And this made our reaction, I think, more efficient. Probably it will become more difficult in the future because in the future there will be more controversy, probably, but because we will have to decide what to open, what not to open. But so far I think that the reaction was well organized and was compact. And I think we would need a similar behavior with climate change. We need a compact, and when I say compact, I mean unified reaction. Unfortunately, this is not happening so far. So, what are we talking about? First of all, we learned about climate change. We realized that there was a climate change when we look at the progress of temperature. We look at the retreat of glaciers, which is something that characterized the second part of the previous century. And we observed the retreat of glaciers, and we observed the increase of temperature. And then a physical explanation developed to attribute to humans the responsibility for that, because the increase of temperature may be caused by the increase of concentration of greenhouse gases. If you look at this picture, this is the physical explanation, which we know very well, of the greenhouse effect. So there is an increase of concentration of certain gases in the atmosphere that cause this greenhouse effect, which means it's like a screen. They create like a screen which traps the radiative emission back from the Earth to the atmosphere and causes an increase of temperature. Now, let's look at the observations. So, first of all, here you get a picture of temperature increase in the period 1950. Through the end of 2013, it's by the NASA and ASA, and you see that the increase of temperature is marked with the red color, yellow and red, and you see that it's not uniform, and in particular in the southern hemisphere, temperature increased less than in the northern hemisphere for reasons that we don't actually know. It's clear that in the northern hemisphere you have more dense population, but actually there is a circulation in the atmosphere, so the greenhouse effect should be not much different. But we have this evidence that climate change, really, if you look at the southern hemisphere and northern hemisphere, took place with different behaviors. If you look at glaciers, there are millions of these pictures, like the ones that I am showing here, millions, and they show that it's dramatic, the retreat of the glaciers, especially in the past 30 years. It's a dramatic retreat, and it's a clear proof that temperature is increasing. There is no doubt on that. I mean, this is not a controversy. This is not the reason of the controversy. Everybody agrees that temperature is increasing, increased a lot in the past 30 years, and basically almost everybody agrees on the fact that humans have had a role in it. So this is another thing to clarify. The reason of the controversy, it's not really in recognizing the role of humans. Almost everybody agrees that humans have a role in it. And in a different way, depending on if you look at the cities, if you look at the mountains, there is a different way, a different extension of the human impact, but still everybody agrees on that. But let's look at some data now. And this is a well-known picture, which is proposed by the NASA. It's one reconstruction of the global temperature. Not reconstruction is not the right term. It's one calculation of the global temperature, which is referred to the period after the Industrial Revolution up to today. And when you start talking now on the progress of temperature, global temperature, in recent years, then some controversy starts because this is what I'm showing to you is a pessimistic picture. It's a reconstruction that, if compared with the others, is a bit more pessimistic. Why there are differences? Because this reconstruction is based on observation. This calculation is based on observation. So why there should be differences between calculations? Differences are given by the fact that during time, measurements techniques have changed and the density of the stations have changed. Differences are given by the fact that given that over the oceans we have less measurements, people compensate with that in different ways. And also, differences arise because some people look at the temperature measured on the ground, like in this case, the picture that you see here. Some other people look at the temperature measured by satellites. Satellites give a more dense coverage, of course, because I mean, you can observe with satellites also over the oceans, so they have an advantage. On the other hand, they cannot estimate temperature close to the ground. They look at the temperature in the troposphere, which is the middle atmosphere. And then these observations are not representative of what happens on the ground. It's a different story. In the troposphere, you have already a mediation, and in the troposphere, you don't see the effect of the urban heat island effect, which is something that is really very important. And actually, we don't know how to take it into account fully. The urban heat island effect is something that is extremely important from a societal point of view because we are talking about increases in temperature in the past 30 years. Like 3 degrees in some cities. In the largest cities, the temperature during summer has increased a lot. And this causes several societal problems because then it triggered the activation of cooling, but the cooling is again providing a positive feedback to heating because it provokes outside an increase of the temperature. Also, it is a problem for the elder people because they are living in cities and 3 degrees may be a lot. And it's also a problem for the temperature measurements because most of the observatories are located within the cities. So, the moral of the story is that if you look at this picture here and you look at the progress of temperature from 1990, look at the red line, 1990. Up to 2000, here it's 2016, and look at the red line because it's a moving average, which is more representative. Then you see that it passed from something like 0.34 to something like 0.94, so it's plus 0.6 degrees. First of all, keep in mind this number because you have to get orders of magnitude very clear. So we are talking about climate change that in terms of temperature means plus 0.6, and this is the more pessimistic prediction in the last 30 years. If you look at satellites, you see a similar increase in the last 30 years, but The magnitude is 0.3, so there is a huge difference. And this is why these different reconstructions may differ. They agree on the fact that there is a general trend, which is the one that you can see in this picture. But the magnitude of this trend is still something that it's not fully agree on. And also, if you look at this picture, please note that there were two periods where we got some cooling. A first period between 1900 to 1910, 10 years of cooling. It was quite a significant cooling, minus 0.2 in 10 years. And then there was another cooling between 1940 up to 1975. It was a period where temperature went down about 0.1, if you look at the red line. There was a max of 0.2 in just 10 years, and then it increased a little bit, and then down again. In fact, this period between 1940 and 1970 was a period when people were much concerned by the threat of global cooling. And you can find also a Wikipedia page. If you look for global cooling, there is a Wikipedia page describing all the reasoning and the scientific studies that were done at that time in the concern that a cooling period was coming. And also, if you look at the magnitude of these decreases and the subsequent increases, so if you look, for instance, from 1910 to 1940, the increase was plus 0.6 in 30 years, precisely the increase that we had in the last 30 years. So I really can't understand why people say that the rate of increase that we experienced in the last 30 years is unprecedented. It suffices that you look at this picture and you see that in a 30-year time span, we had changes that are comparable to those that we are experiencing now. And if you look at the period 1935-1940, we had a plus 0.3, let me see, minus 0.2 plus 0.1, yes, in 7 years. So 0.3 in 7 years compared to 0.6 in 30. So I think the pace of the increase in that period was higher. So I really and genuinely can't understand. I tried also to speak with some climate scientists because they keep saying the rate of increase today is unprecedented. That I asked them, but what about 1940? And they say, no, absolutely. It's 1940 was not significant because it lasted less than 30 years. I'm not really sure. If I look at this picture, I really don't understand some of the basics here of this controversy. Anyway, I think there is no question of the fact that overall it's increasing, and this is indeed something that it's a major issue. I mean, it's a period that is 150 years long, and you got this major increase, which is about, if you look at the global increase from 1880, minus 0.2, to today, it's already more than 1 degree. So this is something that is stunning, and we have to take into account. Okay, now, global warming then. This is called global warming, and as I said, everybody agrees that we are in a warming period, and everybody basically agrees, I put it basically because on the human influence, some people, you may find some people that neglect it, but really few, really few. Okay. Now, the problem is that this increase in temperature triggers other changes. And which are more difficult to quantify. And we are interested in the other changes because sea level rise and water shortage, increase of extremes, these are changes that are very relevant to us and that we have to try to understand. So let's try to better understand this. And here there is a long discussion which I am bypassing because it's a discussion on the controversial character of this debate. I already discussed it. So just have a look at this webpage because there are more details. This controversial topic has stimulated the organization of several conferences by the United Nations. Most of them are promoted by the United Nations. The most important is probably the COP called COP, and it's for instance the Paris Agreement was taken within one of these COP conferences. These conferences also would like to promote a global agreement on initiatives that we should take to reduce the greenhouse emissions. On the other hand, this is something that is not easy for the reasons that you well know. And in particular, the one problem is that in order to reduce the emissions, we have to invest a lot of money and we have to accept reduction in competitiveness of countries over the international market. And this is something that it's, I mean, it's very sensitive because it's not an issue, it's an issue that reflects back on the citizens. So the loss of competitiveness of a country means that if you have a reduction of the gross domestic products, this implies that the country gets into economic impasse, which needs to be resolved by increasing the taxes. So at the end of the story, it looks like a political game, but at the end of the story, it's a game that whose price is paid by the citizens. And therefore, this makes the topic even more controversial. And this is one other thing that I genuinely don't understand in this controversy. It looks like some people look like they believe that it suffices the will of the government to reduce the CO2 emissions. So some people think that it's just the matter of a political decision, while actually it's not only that, it's a matter of willingness to pay of the citizens to pay the price, which is, I mean, it's not only a governmental problem, it's a problem of the price that has to be paid, which has to be paid on the one hand for most of it by the high-income countries because are the countries where the emissions are more relevant. But on the other hand, it's difficult not to convince the government, but to convince the citizens to pay this price. And again, this is something that I really don't understand why people tend to give the responsibility to the governments, while I mean the responsibility is in the people. And if there is the will of the people to pay, it's no problem. But anyway, we are not really interested in the economic implication. We are interested in getting an idea of what is the future scenario that we may get. And it's important that we get a reliable idea of that. Okay, so in order to understand the future scenarios, and let's try to focus on climate then. And I think in order to get this idea as engineers of what the future will be, we have to try to make an effort to understand climate and to understand in what way the human impact may have had a role on climate change. And first of all, it's important to study the natural variability of climate, because we know that we well know that climate is naturally varying, and the assessment of the picture that I proposed to you before, it's a clear demonstration. On the other hand, we know that we had glaciations in the past, and we need to be able to understand some more of this natural variability. Keep in mind that when you talk about natural variability, you are already getting into a very difficult field, because it's already the subject of relevant controversy. Because, you know, we have a big problem here. We don't have long observations, so we don't know anything about the past climate directly. We can get an indication through proxy data, but actually we don't have observations of temperature, we don't have observations of rainfall in the past. And for rainfall, which is we have a lot, it's it goes back 300 years. If you look at temperature, direct observations, we go back to 1860, 1870. So it's not a long period. And therefore, how can we study the natural variability of climate? The only way is to analyze remains, to analyze proxy data. And this, of course, gives ample room to uncertainty and therefore to controversy, because it's difficult to come to an agreed conclusion. First of all, if you're interested in reading a nice scientific paper on that, I suggest this link here, Nature Style Naturally Trendy. This is a quite understandable paper, and it's a very nice contribution. But let's now focus on the big picture, and the big picture is glaciations. Let's try to understand some more. I am lecturing for 5 minutes, maybe couple of minutes more, and then I make a break. So first of all, I just want to tell you one thing that many people don't know. We are currently in a glaciation, and we are in the tail of a glaciation. And if you look at the progress on this graph of temperature, which has been reconstructed through concentration of isotopes in ice carrots, and this figure goes back to up to 542 millions of years ago, and the current time is on the right, you see two moving averages, the blue line and the black line, which clearly show you the position of the relevant four glaciations that we consider as part of the modern era. If you go back far past on the left, you get other two, three glaciations. I don't remember if the total number is seven, probably, which are more uncertain. The four that you see here, and look at the minimum, this is temperature, so you have to look at the minimum, are those that we know with more details. And now we are in the quaternary glaciation, which actually took its minimum about 11,000 years ago. And this is usually what we refer to as the glaciation. Sometimes we say the last glaciation. The last glaciation, actually, it refers to 11,000 years ago, when there was the minimum of the current glaciation. And you don't see this minimum here. You see that here on this figure, the minimum is on the left, right hand. So it looks like we are still decreasing. Actually, this is a moving average. So you don't see the detail of the temperature increasing in the past 11,000 years. But I can show you a detail. Before I show you the detail, keep in mind that the glaciation is defined as a period when you have some ice on the Earth's surface. If you look at these peaks here, you have four peaks. If you look at either the blue or the black line, you have four peaks. And in correspondence of these peaks, there was no ice on the Earth, no ice in the ice caps. Now let's have a look at the recent period. And to have a look, I think the correct link is those of the Quaternary glaciation. Let's see here. I'm not sure. This is the figure I wanted to show you. So this is a different scale. So this is, if you look at the x-axis, is thousands of years ago. So basically, in this figure, you go back half a million. It is something that in the previous figure you can't see. Now let's look at the temperature, which is the highest graph here, is the blue one. You see that the minimum of the current glaciation was about 11,000 years ago, and then we had an increase of temperature, and the increase is the order of magnitude of we passed from minus 8, 11,000 years ago, to zero now, and the zero is set to the current temperature. So there was an increase in these 11,000 years of plus 8. Plus 8 explains the difference between the glaciers that were almost reaching the Po River, and now that the glaciers are confined in the Alps. Look at the other graphs, dust concentration and carbon dioxide, and look at the correspondence between the concentration of carbon dioxide, this is a natural concentration, of course, and temperature variation. When you get the peaks of temperature, you get a peak in the carbon dioxide concentration. Why is that? Because when you have an increase of temperature, you have an increase of temperature of water in the oceans, which causes a massive release of CO2 from the ocean to the atmosphere. Okay, so looking at this picture, you can understand what happened in the recent past, recent thousands of years, and look back again at the temperature in the top. You see that in the same glaciation, because all of this graph is inside the Quaternary glaciation, we have a period with higher temperature, which alternate with periods of lower temperature. These are called glacial and interglacial periods. The meaning of the terms is important. I think it is extremely important to understand that we are in a glaciation now. We are in an interglacial period of a glaciation. Okay? Just to understand what is natural variability. And another thing interesting is that if you look at this period of glacial and interglacial periods, they alternate in quite a regular way, and we don't know what is the reason for that. So we don't know, because in the last interglacial period, 11,000 years ago, we had minus 8 degrees of temperature with respect to now. There might be several possible explanations, maybe volcanic explosions, which increased the concentration of dust in the atmosphere, maybe. There might be Indeed, you see that when you have increasing temperature, you have decrease of concentration of dust, so maybe volcanic explosion. But it might also be impact with meteorites, which may change the inclination of the Earth axis. It may be changes in the orbits of the stars, and in particular of the sun, which causes these changes. It's something that we still don't know. Okay, so let's go back to this figure, and let me, and then I conclude, look at another figure. I go down this one again, different scale. Now we go back from to the year zero. And it's important to look at this picture because you can understand the differences between different temperature reconstructions based on different proxies. And you can also see the presence of the medieval warm period and the subsequent Little Ice Age. So, in the past 500 years, we know from remains and from oral witnesses that in the Middle Age we had a warm period with the temperatures that were comparable to the temperatures that we have now. And then we had a Little Ice Age, which lasted up to 1750. From 1750, we have a steady increase of temperature with an increased slope in the past 30 years. So this is the situation from the very big picture to the small picture. And I think that is extremely important to be aware of these up and downs. Again, people say, climate scientists say, that the trend in the past 30 years is unprecedented in the past 6 million years. I don't really understand, and sometimes I avoid to discuss with them because it's a discussion that it's unpleasant. I don't really understand if I look at the past 300 years, I see that the slope is in some reconstructions has been comparable. But again, it's a controversial topic. Okay, I think we will have a couple of hours more to discuss next time. And now I am stopping here. If you have any question, please step forward. All clear, thank you. Okay, so I would say that I am very grateful to you. You're always encouraging, and thanks. Let's keep in touch. And next week, thank you, Camilla, for the appreciation of the topic. Next week we will fortunately or unfortunately conclude, and if you are interested in developing the exercise that I propose to you, if you let me know before next Tuesday, I would appreciate that, so we can organize how to interact, how I can assist you in that. Thank you, students, and keep safe. Bye-bye.